Hi, welcome to this week's edition of Blues Talk, where John, Dave and myself are going to look back over our victory against Cast in the Heineken Cup, look back over some of the other results and look forward to our game on the weekend against Connacht. Well boys, 19-7 against Cast, bit of a curious egg, another one of our performances. We were kind of good in parts, poor in parts and average in others.
It's good to get a win. Mm-hmm. It's good not to have conceded any match points. I think a lot of people underestimated Castres, whether they forgot that they were French champions or reigning French champions, or had assumed that their lowly position in the league was really reflective of what kind of standard the team is at, considering the way that the league has actually gone in France.
Most teams are 5 yeah. and 4 or 4 from 5.
Exactly, yeah. So there's nothing between the top 10 or 11 or 12 teams in France. So I think people thought the game would be easier than it was. I'm just very, very pleased with the win. I thought there were elements of the performance that were good. There were elements that I'm not so happy with, but, you know, overall, I'd be quite pleased.
Absolutely, yeah. There were people screaming and crying in the high-rise blocks just after the game, perhaps. But I felt that we did fairly well defensively, but we ran out of steam. It was a game of two-thirds and a little bit in the end. It was a game that seemed to turn around 30 minutes and then it turned again around 60 minutes and then it only turned for a few minutes.
Mm. But a lot of those turns, as you say, in the match were because of what Cass did.
Yeah.
Whether they brought on their prop, took off their scrum half,
or
a couple of moments of madness from like the guy that tackled Dave Carney with no arms.
Yeah.
Or when the scrummy put the ball in crooked for the third time and got yellowed.
Yeah, it was criminal, actually. It was, and if you look at it through that lens, if you like, you know, they lost that game. You know, we did well to get back in it and score that excellent try. But, you know, you've just named all the things that they did that lost them the game rather than the things that we did that won the game.
I don't think it lost them the game. What I think is it lost them the chance to win the game. I know it's a semantic argument, but... You know, they didn't lose the game because we did nothing and they made a lot of mistakes. I mean, they lost the game for a whole variety of reasons, some of which include those mistakes you mentioned. I mean, for me, the scrum half, that's he should be taking out a shot.
Yeah.
I mean, it's one thing to be told once, it's another thing to be told twice, but to be told three times.
And he was actually warned because you could hear on the TV afterwards the referee telling him, you know, you got pinged there and the next time you're going in the bin.
I've never seen a player look more incredulous either. I mean, they always look incredulous when they're getting and they shake the heads and all, but he had the arms out and he was just shocked.
There's a journalist, a guy called Andy McGeady, who does kind of a running total on various penalties, or rather the penalising of crooked feeds in the Pro 12, the Premiership and the Top 14. And up until 2 weeks ago, there had been no penalties given for crooked feeds in the top 14. And what happened 2 weeks ago? It was the traditional switch around the refs. Irish refs refed in the top 14, French refs refed in the Pro 12. And that's when the thing... So it's something that's obviously not been adhered to in the top 14. French refs aren't given those penalties. So your man didn't... To a certain extent, in a way, he was almost unfortunate that he was a victim of something he wasn't aware of.
Yeah. Well, he was aware of it, but it's like it's an Irish thing where, you know, Agwan guard, I was, you know, let's off guard, let's off.
Well, like even going back to the Scarlets match earlier on this season for us, you know, I think it was Redden was warned, and then when he came off, Boss was penalised, it was Boss's first opportunity to feed the scrum, and he put it in crooked, and the ref said, "I'm penalising you here," and Boss was, you know, incredulous, and then they said, "Well, your predecessor was
was free kicked.
Yeah,
it's free kick penalty, yellow card, and that goes against the position, not the player.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it was an incredibly stupid thing to do, and whilst I'm certain that it did contribute, it was one of the contributory factors to why Castres didn't win. I'm not sure it's one of the reasons why they lost. I mean, we had something to do with that.
Yeah, no, we defended really well, and I think that Matt O'Connor has been quoted as saying that he wanted to work on our defence first, and that once he gets that in place, we can go looking at the attack to a bigger degree than we have done, and you can kind of see that in the team. considering he's just come into the job, and he said also that he wants a bit of evolution rather than revolution in the style of play, because, like, let's face it, who's going to change such a winning team too much? But he seems to have got the defence really solid. Like, those two Heineken Cup games, with a few little exceptions, we've been very good in defence, and we've been very happy without the ball.
Although their try that the scrum half got, like,
a few little exceptions. Yeah, that was a classic.
Yeah, that's like on page 4 of the coach's coaching book. I mean, if anyone remembers the 2006 Heineken Cup final, the try Munster scored was actually through Peter Stringer is actually a variation on that. Yeah. It's all about getting the blind side defender onto the open side. And that leaves the blind side open, and that's what they did. I mean,
but it's easier to do it from on the right hand side rather than the left hand side.
Much easier. But
the key to it as well is the fact that because they were on top in the scrum, our wing forwards had to stay bound and keep pushing. Mm. And that's like
we actually got the shunt on that scrum.
But they wanted the scrum.
But they wheeled it right.
The shunt is less important than the wheel. Getting the wheel because you're taking away the wing forwards from the position that they'd want to make a tackle in. They have to go that little bit further, and of course they can't break early because it's a penalty, and that's also kind of been something that has been paid attention to this season. Mm-hmm. So what you do is you bring the blind side, you bring your blind side attacker into the open side, so somebody has to go in, otherwise there's an overload there. So you're left with a 2-on-1, and you know, if a team doesn't take a 2-on-1, there's questions.
It was Boss still on, I think, at that stage, and he just broke inside. He ran just as the ball was coming out. He ran the other way. Mm-hmm. And that left Burrell Fergus on his own.
They pulled their winger in between the 12 and 13 slot.
That's why Boss went in.
That's why Boss went in.
So, well worked little ploy there. It fair play to them. They did exactly what it said in the tin on that one.
But I thought when they had their guys in the bin,
Just to go back to that one thing that should be mentioned as well is that you would expect them to score from that with their two absolute best players and two of the best players on the pitch for the entire match, which was Cock at the scrum half and Klassen's the number 8. Mm. They were the two players involved, and they executed it beautifully. Africans. Yeah.
Well, Cock qualifies this season. Klassen's already.
He's already got 3 or 4 caps. Yeah.
Yeah.
For France.
Yeah.
Well, I thought when they had their guy in the bin, we just smelt blood and really, really upped the ante then for the last 20 minutes or so, and like even when the try that we scored was just there was some fabulous lines of running for it. Maybe we have a quick look.
Fabulous lines of running, but there was some poor decision making.
It started with Toner.
Actually, it starts with own Redden turning it over here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was just before that, actually, just before you started there, Toner grabbed the man, threw him in, back in, and Redden hopped over the ball and made the turnover on his own, which was fairly impressive for a scrummy. We had some nice running here. Fergus McFadden got the arms around. Dave Kearney made a nice break. Now, unfortunately,
that was the wrong choice there.
Redden was the man who got the ball rather than Darcy. Darcy might have made a bit more yardage. Still and all, look at that lovely little break from Dave.
He does retrieve the situation already.
Yeah, Fergus McFadden did a nice bit. But when Jack McGrath eventually gets the ball here, it's another phase or two. He really, there was no one stopping him. You could see he had a bit between his teeth. He really, and he had a little bit to do as well. He had a couple of...
It's not like he had to fall over the line. I mean, he has to hand off two guys.
Exactly. And Jamie took a massive hit there. Oh, I'd be in hospital if that was me. In fact, I'd probably be in a coffin. There he goes.
Klassen's and Wiongi.
I mean, to get past those two guys is just...
Here's Devin Toner's tackle. It's a very nice tackle, actually.
And then Redden got in over the ball on his own, which is also impressive. It was a nice turnover. And here we see them again.
See, this is the pass that annoys me, and I guarantee it's the pass that Matt O'Connor was annoyed with as well.
Yeah, Darcy with more pace and more go forward should have taken that pass.
In fairness, the ball carrying from the wingers here, both wingers in tandem, was excellent, wasn't it?
Yeah, they linked up well, and there's Jack. Little bit of assist there from who was that? Was assisting him? Was that?
21 is on Redden.
Oh, it was on Redden, wow.
But it reminded me of some of the tries that Keane Healy scored in his career. You know, it's like just uber power from 5-10 metres out and just barrels over.
Nobody's stopping him, yeah. It's great to see that in a guy so young.
Mm-hmm. But it's like we said about Boston, it's like we said about Madigan. What has Keane Healy got over Jack McGrath? His play in the loose. Mm-hmm. So McGrath has to add that, and it's good to see that he's trying to do so.
Yeah, but it's sort of going back to what we had in the front row a couple of years ago, you know, a lot of interchangeable players, and if one front row goes off, that the ones that are coming on are nearly equally as good.
Well, you see, that's the thing. I mean, people talk about Leicester scrum, and you were mentioned earlier about it going back. It was under pressure, but it never buckled.
No.
It buckled, but it never cracked, rather. They always gave enough time for Jamie Heaslip to get the ball off the back.
Well, he did some fabulous cleaning up work.
Oh, yeah.
He did everything to get the ball off the back on his own. There was a scrum on 30 minutes where they brought on their loose head prop, and he changed the scrum completely. Mm-hmm. We were flying backwards, and Heaslip was quite near the line. It was maybe 10 metres out, and Heaslip did Trojan work in getting the ball out, and how he got the ball out, because
what they were
backpedaling at a rate of knots.
They were doing a three-man shove on our put-in. And if you look at the scrum statistics, we actually won ball in the scrum. They never actually won ball in the scrum.
Yeah.
We won their ball in the scrum, rather. We won against the head. They never actually won one against the head. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you're going to go backwards in that situation. But what we did was we held it up long enough for Jamie to get the ball off the back. And the encouraging thing was when we changed the front row, which we did,
mm-hmm.
the replacement front row was able to hold its own, including the much maligned Mr. Michael Bent, who did well enough to, you know, to justify his position on the bench.
Most of the scrums after he came on ended with them being penalised for crooked in.
That was where they all came in.
There wasn't a huge. He didn't have to do that much, but yeah, he did keep his end up.
Mm-hmm.
Well, one guy that was very encouraging with our one performance was Luke Fitzgerald. I thought he had a fine game when he came on in the second half, and he just looked so eager for work and wanted to be on the ball an awful lot.
He's an electrifying player. When you see him, when he gets the ball, you always have that sense that something is going to happen, that he's going to create something, he's going to make an opportunity. And he did. He uses his quick feet to get over the gain line a number of times during the match. And he's got great hands as well. It was really nice to see him back. He looks to be in really good physical condition. Yeah.
And he's kind of gone a bit Fergus McFadden now. He seems to have put on a lot of power in the upper body now. You can see him going at people where he possibly mightn't have before, and he can... He's like a back rower nearly in the way he can wrestle the ball and, you know, get in and mix it with some of the forwards.
Like he was on our wing for most of the second half, and his feet are just sensational. Like he was really getting the ball in a confined space, and he was taking steps, and he was making, you know, 5-10 meters each carry he got. Like he was really encouraging to see him back.
Yeah, he creates just that. I mean, he doesn't have to beat the guy with his feet, but what he does is he gives himself the opportunity to take the tackle on his own terms.
Yeah, but it's just a momentum. Yeah. You don't have to be 1 meter over the gain line to make sure that their backs go back on their heels.
Well, that's what it's about, and it was great to see him back after a long and, I'm sure, frustrating thing. Possibly one of the reasons, because he's had so many lower body injuries.
Yeah,
he's had that opportunity to work on his upper body strength.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm.
Well, his lower body has come back to the degree that he can do all that tricky stuff with his feet and create stuff in tight spaces, because that was his big party trick always, and to see that he still has it after cruciate and all those other problems he had is very encouraging.
It's great. Two other lads I thought Heaslip and O'Brien again had magnificent games. I mean, Sean O'Brien, we mentioned him a couple of weeks ago after the Munster match, and he did look a bit ring rusty, but my god, he's certainly come back and playing like a Trojan.
He's got the Brillo pad out, because there's no rust to be seen anywhere in any element. Okay, one or two of his offloads were ill-chosen, shall we say. But in terms of his carrying the ball, in terms of his tackling, in terms of his rucking, his turning over the ball, it was... And he gave an absolutely 100% complete display of open side flanker play. There was no facet of the game.
That's exactly what I was about to say. Yeah.
And you mentioned Jamie, and Jamie I thought had a superb game. But Kevin McLaughlin as well had a great game.
Yeah, back were our best. You know, you could say.
I mean, he was quietly efficient. He wasn't as showy as the other guys, but he made his tackles. He hit the rucks. He slowed up opposition ball. He made ground when it was required. He trucked up. If you notice, the guy who they give the nasty ball to is always Kevin, and he just makes a silk purse out of it. You know.
Yeah, he tidies up a lot of dirty ball, and he'll break the gain line as well, and he'll drive somebody back with the ball. You know, he's not a He's not Luke Fitzgerald. He's not going to create space with his feet, but he creates space with his
shoulders.
Exactly. And head goes down. You can see that scrum cap breaking through a few guys. So, yeah, between all three of the back row, I was very impressed. But Sean stood out.
What he does is it kind of what you were saying earlier, making that yard, making that 1 yard to set them back on their heels.
Mm.
And that's he specializes in that. Because, as you say, as we were saying, it's dirty ball. It's not ball you're going to expect a clean break from.
Mm-hmm.
But it does enough to give to give us time for the next phase.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, well, we can't obviously go without mentioning Gothbert. I mean, he was man of the match, which I was quite surprised when I heard he was man of the match, because his what he was...
I think somebody spelt Gothbert wrong. It was supposed to be spelled O, possibly B or I, E, N.
Exactly, yeah. But, like, he did kick 5 from 6, I think he got 14 points.
Well,
he had a very mixed game. Yeah.
But he certainly wasn't flawless. Like, he missed... I remember he... Especially when we needed it. I think it was just after they scored their try. He didn't kick the ball 10 metres.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's at that time that you do need somebody to settle the ship again. And when
he kicked a lot of aimless ball as well. He kicked away. And he kicked stuff into hand that was either too long or that was going straight to their back three. But he did do good stuff. And I think I was on here saying last week that he should be picked. That the previous week I wanted to see Madigan. But this week I was happy from the start on merit after his game in the Ospreys. Now, he was a notch back from that game in the Ospreys for sure.
Mm.
He wasn't shown as committed a game. And I thought they should have brought Madigan on at 10 rather than where they did. Now, funny, when I was at the game, I thought Madigan should have been brought on with Redden. When Redden came on at 10, and that we could have really drove on from there. But the game wasn't safe then.
Mm.
And the reason we played Gothbert was to keep the two things, as opposed to a conservative choice to keep their big pack turning around and having to go behind for ball all the time, and also just to keep a bit of game management. And the game certainly still needed to be managed at the time when Redden came on. But I still would have liked to see Madigan.
Reviews of Gothbert's performance have varied from Shane Horgan giving him man of the match, which he wasn't, to some of the kind of the reviews who have him as a worse out half than Eddie Heckenui. neither are accurate.
Mm.
He was functional. He wasn't brilliant, but he wasn't poor either.
I'd give him a higher ranking than functional.
You know, but he was. Mm. But to a certain extent, all I ever want from an out half is functional. David Holwell was functional. He did it really well, but he was still. That's all you kind of really want. I mean,
Nick Evans.
You want someone who can just control the game. And okay, he had elements of his game that I wasn't happy with, like, for example, the kicking, and that restart was poor. But in the main, he did control the game. I'm not convinced that giving them the ball wasn't actually a tactic.
Yeah.
Because O'Connor has faith in our defensive line. Kick the ball and then, you know, take it off him kind of thing. But I thought he played well. I don't think there was ever a bonus point in that game for us.
No.
I think that they were way, way better than a lot of people gave him credit for. Whether Madigan had played, I'd say even Johnny Sexton wouldn't have gotten a bonus point out of that game for us.
Yeah, I think, like, a lot of it comes down to leadership. And you know, a lot of our leaders weren't playing in that game. So you need somebody who's got experience and can steady a ship. Like, and you think, you know, Cullen wasn't playing, Jennings wasn't playing, and O'Driscoll weren't playing.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got automatically that three of the main leaders within the team. So therefore, you're going to have to put faith in a guy who's played Super 15 rugby. He's in his late 20s. He's been there, done that sort of thing. Whereas Madigan's still quite relatively inexperienced. Mm. And going in against a team that are French champions, you know, you got to pick horses for courses.
Yeah, and, you know, one of the reasons you would pick Madigan is because he's for the future. But, you know, you got to deal with the present.
Yeah, but like, maybe that's what the match against Connacht is for, you know.
Mm.
See, a lot of what Madigan did was last year, and Matt O'Connor wasn't here last year, so it's meaningless, to be perfectly honest. Yeah. Matt O'Connor saw Jimmy Gopper play really, really well last year.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't see Ian Madigan play that well, you know.
Or that often.
So, you know, there's an element to that. I mean, Madigan is, I still think, has all the tools to become an Irish international out half. Maybe not a starting for Ireland, with obviously Mr. Sexton still there, depending on how he goes. But he certainly has all the tools. But he's just going to have to get an opportunity to prove them. And the thing is that Gopper is doing what we wanted him to do. It's what we want every foreign player to do. Or every second choice. Okay. It's what we want every player who is perceived to be second choice to do. Mm-hmm. Put pressure on the guy ahead of him.
Exactly.
Isn't that exactly what we wanted Gopper to do?
Yeah. Well, anyway, so that result leaves us in the exact same position as last season. Two wins from two. And
but it doesn't.
Only nominally. Two wins from two, 8 points.
Yeah.
Last season, we played Heineken Cup debutants and a fairly shambolic Welsh outfit. This season, we played the top 14 champions and our absolute bogey team.
Mm. Who are having a shambolic season.
Who are having a shambolic season.
Shambolic Heineken Cup season.
Heineken Cup season, but they're still our bogey team. Mm-hmm. And I mean, wins in Swansea are as rare as hen's teeth for Leinster anyway. So, what you say is correct, that numerically we're in the same position. In terms of the actual achievement, it's far in the
And there seems to be a lot more positivity about it.
Claremont were on 10 points, though, and we were on 8.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Northampton are not on 10 points.
No.
They're on 5, I think.
Yeah,
so,
that's right.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And Northampton, Franklin's Gardens, while we may not win there, is not half as scary as
Stade Michelin,
where nobody's won in now 65 games. Nobody has won a match there. So, you know.
Well, that brings us nicely on.
I mean, we actually came as close as anyone.
Anyone did, yeah. We're a crap line out away from winning.
Yeah.
Sorry, that brings us on to the Saints Ospreys match, which there was no try bonus point for the Saints, even though they won fairly handily in the end.
They could have had one, really.
I think it was just at the end they knocked on.
They went for the posts when they could have had one, and they were fairly safe in the game at that stage. I wouldn't have taken much daring now to go for a bonus.
I don't know.
Point.
I thought the second half, Ospreys. I mean, it was a game very much of two halves. In the first half, Ospreys didn't turn up at all, really, did they? And they were very, very poor. But in the second half, I thought they were. If not the dominant team, they were certainly the team that was on top for more of the match or more of that half. Mm. But they left themselves far too much to do. There's going to have to be an awful lot of soul searching in that Ospreys team about, you know, what they're at. Because the only thing is in the Ospreys favour is now they have a team who can actually look at themselves rather than look at themselves in the mirror.
Mm.
So they have a chance of turning it around. But I don't know what they were doing in the first half of that match. They looked like they didn't know there was a game on, or they hadn't heard the whistle. I don't know, but
yeah,
well, there are no points. I mean, like, there's no chance they'll get out.
They're out. They're gone. Yeah. They're gone. All they can do is be a speed bump.
Well, they got to play for pride now and derail some of Cast or Northampton. They've got Cast in the back to back, haven't they?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if they could put a dent in them, it'd be very nice.
Yeah, and obviously our back-to-backs against the Saints is going to be crucial, really, now at this stage. Even though we're 3 points ahead of Saints, that can all change.
Win this game over in Franklin's Gardens and we're big time in the driving seat. Lose it and we could still win the group, but if we could just win that game.
Yeah, and obviously one of the other big matches of the weekend was Munster against, who were they playing against, Dave?
They were playing Gloucester, and the reason I call them Gloucester is because that wasn't a Gloucester team. The Gloucester team played the previous week, and then they changed 12 of them, so Gloucester took their place.
Mm. Mm. But a poor display by Munster, really. Like, I mean, they played a team that was pretty much Gloucester's seconds, and still didn't manage to get a...
Who was the out half? I never even heard of him before. Barton or I can't even remember his name. He was a Kiwi, I think, but he missed a couple of crucial kicks at the beginning, and you know, they just didn't look up to much. And Munster struggled to put them away.
It was actually worrying. It was a very, very poor quality game. Mm. The game itself was just poor quality. I don't know whether that's because when Gloucester appeared, Munster thought that it was going to be easy. Now, ultimately, it kind of was for them because they didn't have to play that well. And they didn't play well, or expend that much energy to beat them in the end. But, you know, you'd have to wonder if Gloucester had shown up, how it would have been different.
Gone, yeah. Well,
you know, it's hard to know.
Because one
thing about Munster is, and you have to give them credit for this, no matter how good a team they have or how bad a team they have, they always manage to stand up to the challenge kind of thing.
Mm.
So it would have been interesting to see what had happened if Gloucester had played.
Mm. Remember, we'll see. Over in Gloucester in January. There were some other great games, like the Cardiff-Toulon game and it was great to see Cardiff, you know, like at the end of the match, like their crowd went bananas, they did the pitch invasion and, you know, like all of their Lions players stood up and that guy Copeland seemed to have a fine game. He was given man of the match and he was going ballistic at the final whistle.
Yeah,
somebody on Twitter said that they've seen they've seen a lot of these players been selected 50 or 60 times. Was the first time they've ever seen them play. And you know, you look at that Cardiff team should be capable of beating Toulon. Yeah. I mean, you look at the name, you look at the names on the team sheet, and that's a really good team.
Should
now
be, yeah.
They've never done it, but they did it on Saturday, and fantastic, fair play to them.
They used to be good competitor. I mean, they used to be the best Welsh region in the Heineken Cup up until maybe 4 years ago or so. And
they got to the semi-final.
They're
beaten by Leicester,
on a penalty shootout. Yeah. And then, the year we won.
And then Jamie Roberts came back with two tries. They were 14 points down with 5 minutes to go or something, and Jamie Roberts scored two tries to bring them back in, and then they lost on penalties.
And then they got to the quarterfinal a couple of seasons after that.
Yeah. And they won the Amulet.
They were destroyed by us. Yeah. European champions.
We see them week in, pretty much week in, week out. We see a very mixed bag. Yeah. We see a lot of disinterest from them.
But especially when you consider their result against Exeter the previous week, where they were stonked, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think probably the most notable result of the weekend was Montpellier being stonked by Ulster.
Ulster.
It was a handy enough win in the end. Montpellier responded to the Ulster pressure that was being put on them, and there was a lot of Ulster pressure being put on them by giving away penalties, and Jackson and Pienaar were quite happy to kick them.
Yeah.
I saw Jackson scored an absolute beauty. The last penalty of the match was an absolute beaut from Jackson. Lovely, lovely kick.
The try that Trimble scored, it reminded me a little bit of the one that Hickey scored against Toulouse in 06.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of the interchange
Hickey
of passes.
From the corner,
yeah.
That one.
Mm.
Yeah.
No, they were very, very good, Ulster. I have a sneaking suspicion that they're going to be the team that they look to me like the form team for Europe
it
this
does,
season.
It does, doesn't it? I mean, when you consider like the signings, like they're getting older, as I said earlier, they're ducks in a row now. Like but they've got Pienaar in, they've signed the other scrum half, Marshall.
Chris Henry for three years.
Like, they're starting to keep their squad players. You know, they're really making a statement that they want to win something.
The impressive thing about them is how they can go out and win without guys that last year we thought were the guys that the team has been built around.
Yeah.
They've been going out and they've been winning without Afoa. They've been winning without Williams. Paddy Wallace has been a mainstay of that team. He hasn't been seen. They've Bow, they've Trimble, they've Gilroy. Gilroy is another guy that's in and out.
Mm-hmm.
They've a lot of strength in the centres now.
They've a lot of depth that they didn't have 18 months ago.
That's really what you need. It's not... A good first 15 will take you so far in Europe to win in Europe. And this is why we won. We won because we had 23 players of the exact same standard, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you need. And I think Ulster are getting there now.
Yeah,
I wonder, though, if, like, because they're playing so well and they kind of are, I presume, sort of the form team in Ireland, say, that might be reflected then in the autumn internationals. There might be more fellas called up. And as a result, we know from our past that sometimes when you take players out of the club environment and you bring them into the internationals, they can get injured.
Be careful what you wish for.
It can be a little bit.
I'd agree with that, but I think that's why you need the strength, and that's why we had the depth. That's why you need the depth, and I think that's what Ulster have now. I mean, it would be a terrible thing for Ulster if they were to lose Luke Marshall, say, to injury.
Yeah.
But who's backing up Luke Marshall?
Stuart Olding.
Can you think of anything more exciting than seeing Stuart Olding?
Mm.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, superb. I mean, Craig Gilroy isn't even in the team.
And
so if Bower or Trimble get injured, who are key men,
I think
Craig Gilroy steps in.
That's a lot to do with their, whatever they call it, your team culture, your team spirit, your team, whatever they call it nowadays, ethos, brand. But they really play for each other now. And not that they didn't before, but that they're really...
tight.
They're tight, and you can change the people in the jerseys, but the jersey's still just as hard to beat. And I think that's going to stand to them. I think they'll have to pick up silverware this year somewhere or get very, very close. And
yeah, well, I think
one, if not both competitions.
We kind of mentioned at the start of the season that this is really make or break for them.
Make or break year,
and, you know, you'd like to think that because they've been unlucky in the Heineken there against us a few years ago and then obviously the Pro 12 last season, that they are building a very, very strong team that I think is going to be challenged towards the...
Well, that's it. You need that bit of adversity.
Mm.
Maybe you don't need so much adversity, but you do need that because you need to have that in the makeup to know what it's like, to know that you don't want to go there again kind of thing. Between that and the strength and depth that they have and, you know, the experience that's now in the team. I mean, you're looking at... people are talking about Paddy Jackson. He's what age is he, 21, 22?
Yeah, 21.
Is this his third full season in Europe or his fourth?
Something like that.
That's a lot of stuff to store away, you know.
Yeah.
And of course they have Pienaar and Marshall, and you know, a lot of their young guys are very experienced. Mm-hmm. Like we were saying, like Darren Cave is still not that old, although he's what, 26 or 27.
Yeah.
Luke Marshall's going into his second or third season in Europe. Craig Gilroy has been there and seen that he's played in a European final. Mm-hmm. Ian Henderson has done the same. So
yeah.
You've got all these young players,
mm-hmm.
but very experienced young players. And they're in kind of a similar situation as we were with the likes of Luke and Rob and
mm-hmm.
Jamie Heaslip. By the time we came to win it, they were young players who'd experienced
but isn't it very encouraging to see that their homegrown players are coming true?
Yes.
Rather than, you know,
oh, yeah.
a couple of years ago I was a little bit skeptical that I thought they might have been like a bought-in team, you know, because while all of the Irish teams are allowed to have five foreign players,
mm-hmm.
generally speaking we rarely started a match with all five foreigners starting, whereas Ulster were, you know, they built their team around it. But now when you see all these young Irish guys coming through, and when you say, like you mentioned there, Ofoa wasn't playing, Williams wasn't playing, you know, that they're even say, like, you know, when the year that they got to the final against us, they had Terblanche on the wing
yeah.
rather than giving a young Irish guy a chance, even though he was sort of a medical joker that was signed in.
They used their guys really well. They used those guys that they signed really well, and they like we did with guys like Ollie LaRue. They were able to build the team rather than, you know, they were able to add to the team
mm.
rather than subtract. Where you're saying you can subtract by not giving a guy a break, a young Irish player, and that's always the conundrum with buying in players. You're going to be blocking an Irish guy, but if you get Ollie LaRue's and guys like that, they can learn so much
yeah.
from their the young Irish talent can learn so much from them that it actually benefits rather than. And I think Ulster are. Because they've developed so many people, you could say that those five guys were a third of their starting 15 in the Heineken Cup 2 seasons ago.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they're not. I mean, Ofoa, they can live without Ofoa.
Vandenberg's gone.
Vandenberg is gone, but out of the guys they have now, they've Mueller, Ofoa, Williams, Pienaar, and who's the other one? Payne, who's going to become Irish qualified at the end of the season. So, like, Payne becomes Irish qualified, blends into the fabric of the team.
Mm-hmm.
Ofoa and Mueller are probably gone.
Ofsky, yeah.
And they'll probably do without them, you know. Pienaar is there long term, which is great. And you've Nick Williams, who's also signed on another contract, actually, there's somebody we didn't mention. He signed, I think, 2 years, was it?
Mm-hmm.
Which is probably the best
mm-hmm.
Nick Williams, you know. After another 2 years, I don't know how effective his game.
You see, you sign
be.
The right foreign players. You're not signing a player. You're signing a legacy.
Yeah.
You look at Munster when they signed Jim Williams, John Langford.
Mm-hmm.
You look at us with Ollie LaRue, with
Rocky,
Issa, and even with Ulster before when they had Andy Ward. He was a legacy player. He set a standard that other guys came through to follow.
Yeah.
So, if you sign the right guy and somebody like, I can't see Roon Pienaar being the kind of fella who's not going to share his experience with the next generation, you know. He's going to want to keep his shirt, but he's not going to be mean about it. You can see it coming through. You see the players coming through and the way they're playing, the confidence they're playing with. So I'd have Ulster as my favourites for the European Cup this year.
I don't know. I'd say it'd probably be a French team, but yeah, you never know. Ulster Toulon would be an interesting game, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
It would, yeah.
Well,
but one team that is kind of bought in is Saracens, and they played in front of 60,000 in Wembley
yeah.
On Friday night against Toulouse.
I nearly felt sorry for them. I know Dave was going to laugh, but
I felt sorry for them because I'll tell you why. Because Toulouse are a poison to watch, and I never thought I'd say that about. And it's the saddest thing I've ever said about a rugby team. Toulouse, who were the standard bearers for not only how a club should be, but how the game should be played, are a run of the mill, big fat number 8, huge pack French team. That's all they are. They have nothing else.
That number 8 is some fella, isn't he?
He's a big lad, all right.
Now you wouldn't run him around Marley Park. I know, but that's all they are. I mean, you look at French teams. How many times have we seen French team come over here? Even Castres, you know, with their big number 8. And, you know, Racing Metro came over a couple of years ago with the same kind of thing. You see all these teams come over. And it's a tactic that's popular in France. I don't know why. But the point is that Toulouse have sunk back down to this level. Toulouse were never that kind of team. They are now, and it's sad to see.
Mm. Well, final last match we'll talk about is Zebre against Connacht, which was good for Connacht, I suppose.
Great win for Connacht.
Great win for Connacht. However, I was disappointed that they decided not to go for their tries when, you know, they went for kicks at goal of quite a few times when they had opportunities to go for possession.
Would you say that's Dan Park's influence?
Well, I think they probably just wanted to get the win, you know.
I think it might be Pat Lamb's influence. I think he wants to, you know, okay, they didn't go for the bonus points, but, you know, when things are tricky a bit later in the season, if you have a few...
Like, they've only won, that's their second win out of seven fixtures this season.
He wants a couple of wins in their bellies, a couple of wins under their belt, because when things get tough, at least you can fall back on those to bring something out of yourself when you're facing a bit of adversity. So, yeah, no, I think it was the right... You know, it's easy to say, oh, he should have gone for things, but, you know, for Connacht, getting an away win in the European Cup, even against Zebre, is very, very important. And I think that this was a game that Zebre are massively disappointed to have lost. I've been looking at their Twitter feed and stuff, and I don't speak any Italian, but Google Translate has been my friend, and they were very disappointed. Now, they're not complaining about losing because they were well beaten. Yeah. That's what they're disappointed about, the fact that they were well beaten.
If you consider really...
Because they had targeted the game.
It's probably their own, like... feasibly their only chance of winning a European Cup match this season. Yeah. You know, it's against Connacht equally as poor in the league with them, and obviously their other matches are going to be against Saris and Toulouse, so, you know.
Don't see him picking up too many points in those games.
No.
Well, although I have to say that if they were to beat Saracens, I would actually shit myself laughing. I really would. I would absolutely shit myself laughing.
Well, I hope you have a camera, Dave. Well, anyway, Connacht are opponents next weekend in the RDS. So I guess, are we going to rest many of the Heineken Cup players? Are we going to see Madigan playing for Goppert?
The only people, sorry, cutting across you, but the only people we're going to rest, or we should be resting, are the people who the IRFU or the Ireland Team Ireland want us to rest, because everybody else is getting a break for 2 weeks anyway. I mean, in Friday week, they've got a few weeks off unless they're playing for Ireland. So guys like Brendan Macken don't need a rest. Guys like Jamie Heaslip maybe do. Sean O'Brien has only played 3 games.
Yeah.
Probably doesn't need a rest. Stick him in at 8 for Jamie Heaslip. But
I can see maybe Luke coming in for the replace of either one or either of the
I don't see there been vast changes. I see the halfbacks changing, the starting halfbacks changing. Yeah. I don't know if Darcy's going to be involved this autumn all that much. I don't know.
Hard to know.
I don't know if he is or not. So I could see very little changes in the centres. I'd say we'll see Mr. Kirshner in, Luke, maybe Takiri if he's fit.
Takiri on a wing or
Jennings.
Jennings back, well, he's done his water boy duty, which generally indicates 1 week
very
out.
Infallible, that is, you know.
And I'd say we'll go with McGrath, Moore. I don't know who they play between them. You see, they might want Cronin to have another run out. I mean, his line out throwing was very shonky.
Yeah, it was a little.
So they might want him to have another run out.
It's his one weakness of his game, really, isn't it? Yeah, like, he's improved so much. His fitness has improved.
He has all the stuff that he does that you don't expect. But
it's, you know, like a hooker needs to do two things: throw the ball in and hook it in the scrum.
He can't do them, you know. I mean, it's a criticism we've had of Rory Best over the last couple of years. I mean, Rory Best is a brilliant scrummager. He's been fantastic around the park.
Great over the ball.
But if you can't throw the ball into a line-out... I mean, we said it ourselves a couple of years ago. There's twice as many line-outs as scrums in a match. I mean, there's how many line-outs did Leinster have on Saturday? Was it 10?
I don't know.
We lost 3 or 4 of them. Mm. We lost 4 of them, I think, through Crooked's Crows. I mean, that's a huge amount of possession. Yeah. And top of the line-out ball is great attacking ball.
Yeah.
So, you know, he's going to have to look at that. So maybe they want him to have another game to try and sort
possibly,
that out.
Yeah. Best will probably start for Ireland, so there'd be no harm in giving Cronin a bit of extra game time.
Yeah.
The only thing, from a Leinster point of view, he's out on his own. He's our starting hooker, so, you know, we've got to say
we do have to nurture him
every time he goes near a contact, because he gets hurt. Where, you know, we've got Dundon can step up, fair enough. But
then it's quite callow below that,
going,
really.
Below
a lot
that.
Of young, very young lads, really.
Below that, you're into the academy.
Converted prop in the academy. Like, the guy's good, James Tracy, he's a good guy, but would you throw him into the Heineken Cup?
Like, we beat them fairly handily 17-0 in the corresponding fixture, but they did murder us down in the sports ground about a year ago.
Yeah.
So, like, they're no mugs.
They've beaten us once in the professional era in Dublin, which is 11 years ago, 12 years ago, so something like that. So, you know, statistics are not on their side. However, you just can never write them off.
You might see, though, that, like, as you say, Zebra might have picked out last week's game against Connacht. You know, Connacht were quite a bit aggrieved, and they don't really seem to like us that much, especially after their perceived or our perceived poaching of McCarthy, even though
they'd be better like us after getting into the Heineken Cup several years in a row. Thank you, Leinster.
They'd be playing in a feckin' field out in feckin' Connemara if it wasn't for us. I was only joking, by the way. No, I mean, they have got this. I mean, they always have this chip on their shoulder, and if there isn't one, they can generally find something to manufacture one about. It's noticeable that the guy who was whinging most about the McCarthy thing has been shown the door. But anyway, I just don't think Connacht, I don't think are as strong as they were last year. I just don't think they are. I mean, they've got some good players in.
Yeah. But they should be, on paper, stronger.
Some of them not settling, and other. I mean, James Soialu apparently is out now for a couple of weeks with an injury. Between that and the injuries they have, I don't see them being good enough this time around. It might be a different thing in the reverse fixture.
I'm looking forward to seeing Clark, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to see him up close, you know, because I thought he was a super player.
I'm looking forward to seeing him. I'm looking forward to seeing a couple of their players, actually, because they have some good players that I enjoy watching.
White is out as well, isn't he?
Yeah. Yeah, he is, yeah.
There's a few fellas there.
James Harris Wright is apparently injured as well.
A few of our old boys. So. Yeah, well, so we're fifth in the league. We're on 14 points with two wins and a draw. So we're kind of, our form in the Rabo has
and
been.
A loss, sorry.
But we've been, our form has been quite up and down.
I can't see us going up too many places because, you know, barring Munster getting absolutely destroyed in Glasgow, which.
Yeah, that's first against second.
Top of the table clash there. Ulster are going to win against, I think
they're playing Cardiff.
But
it's in Ravenhill. So.
It's in Ravenhill.
Bonus point win for Ulster.
That's in the bank. And who else is ahead?
Ospreys play Dragons.
Are playing the Dragons, and Ospreys are at home. So none of them are going to lose.
Mm.
Obviously, one of the top two teams has to lose, but unless Munster lose by a lot and we get a bonus point.
The only thing I can say is, on the normal run of things, you wouldn't expect Munster to win, beat Glasgow, but there would be some serious chips on Munster's shoulders after what happened there last year. I mean, that was a serious man-shaming that they took over there.
You would have thought there'd be a serious chip on their shoulder against Gloucestershire
the
other day. And there wasn't really.
So. Well, that's true. But I'm just trying to think of reasons how Munster will.
Well, their last visit.
How Munster could generate.
Their last visit to Scotland wasn't very successful.
It wasn't, no. But I'm just trying to think of how Munster might be able to generate what they need within themselves to try and beat Glasgow.
Yeah.
Because I do.
Play the correct team. What's his name? Stadler.
Well, you know, I think they have to now, haven't they? They've got a few injuries.
I think Ryan is out. Looks like he's going to miss the
Autumn Nations.
Yeah, he seems like a bad injury.
Yeah.
The
Ryan is out. Nagel is out. They're actually a bit stuck at second row. Obviously, they have Dock and Pock. And in fairness to Dunacol Callaghan, he's been playing very well this season.
Yeah.
Since he got dropped, he's upped his game. And in a way, you have to admire that in a guy who's realised that, you know, he has to be better and goes about making himself better. I do admire that from him.
He always keeps himself in good nick. Yeah. Famously, he looks after himself, which, you know, you've also got to admire in a guy who's whatever age he is, 32, 33. Yeah. He's knocking on now.
Well, people
he's a year older than Paulie, I think.
Is he 32?
Whatever age Paulie is,
he's not actually that old. For a second row, the way modern second rows are, he's not actually that old. So he's
played a lot of rugby, though.
He has an awful lot of miles on the clock,
Yeah, because he's played like in the back row, even going back maybe 12 years ago, he was playing for Munster.
Turn of the century, he was getting games in the back row as a young fella. So, I just don't see Munster having enough to beat Glasgow, especially if Glasgow have their full team available to them. I just don't see Munster having enough to do it. Ulster will win. Ospreys Dragons, I wouldn't be so sure about that.
It's a local derby.
It's a local derby, and those games are notoriously nasty.
And especially if, at the moment, so.
It's just, you know, you wouldn't know what way Ospreys are going to react after. Pretty much, that's their European season out of the way now, and they can either turn around and say, "Right, we're going to go for the Pro 12," or they can just implode.
Yeah. You never know. So,
we won't debate it too much. But there was one piece of news today that the Welsh regions have come out and
regional rugby Wales.
That's the one, and they've come out and said that. They seem to be throwing their lot behind the Rugby Championship Cup, or whatever it's called, Champions League Cup.
The Jolly Nice Good Chaps Rugby Cup or something, I think it's called. TM.
TM. Well, I mean, Dave, we spoke earlier, me and you and John spoke earlier about it, but you seem quite bullish that it means nothing, but I would be a little bit concerned.
A little bit worrying. Yeah.
I think the most significant thing about the entire statement is the date.
Oh, yeah.
I really do think, I mean, we've seen it's a PRL tactic throughout the entire duration of this process to release incendiary and divisive statements the week before, or the day before in big meeting. Now, the Welsh regions, whoever, whatever power that they possess within Welsh rugby is subject to the debate.
But I'm just concerned that it's not just the English and French now, that the Welsh...
Yeah. Now it's the Welsh and the English because it's not the French anymore.
I still am concerned that the Welsh are voicing their support for the English. Mm. Because it's clear that the Welsh way that their regions are set up aren't attracting sponsors. They're not able to keep their players. And they're certainly not attracting supporters through the turnstile.
And as you've said several times before here, Jason, about it being local derbies against Bristol, and you know they're geographically, Wales and England are
Wales and England have a relationship that goes back to the 15th century, and the relationship has always been master and servant. Even in rugby, despite when Welsh clubs were very strong in the 50s, 60s and 70s, the English clubs never rated them, even then. You look at what happened the last time there was a Welsh breakaway. The English clubs didn't even bother their backside sending out first teams against them. Then when there was the LV Cup, which was a first team competition, the English teams didn't even send out first teams in it. Mm. It had to be regraded because the English teams don't... I mean... You don't really mess around. They don't like to play with the staff.
But Dave, if you remember, they only brought in national leagues into England in the mid-80s.
Yeah.
And prior to that, fixtures were generally filled by a bunch of friendlies. And some of the biggest friendlies were Anglo-Welsh matches, whether it was Bath and Cardiff, Llanelli and Bristol, these kind of things, which are local derbies, because it was the closest thing at a club game of an international.
Yeah.
And there is a history and a tradition there of those fixtures. Like, I think when Bath play Cardiff, there's a little doll that they hang from the goalposts. Like, it's going back donkey's years ago.
That's all very well and good, but that stopped. We saw it stop. We saw the 200 people turning up when Swansea and Cardiff pulled out of the Welsh League before.
But it stopped because...
The English have their own game now.
They have their own league. Yeah. But now, Dave, now they want to encompass the English and the French and now the Welsh. They want to have that. And they're slowly and surely chipping away.
Will it
affect the rebel is the other thing.
That's the other thing. I mean, you know, that's the other side. Regional Rugby Wales can say all these things to England, and they can say, right, well, but then they'll only be left for four fixtures a year, you know. Because, you know, it could be the other Rabo nations could, or the other Pro 12 nations could say, well, fine, off you go, see us. And bye-bye, by the way. But it won't happen, because at the end of the day, it's not a statement from the WRU. It hasn't been echoed at the time that we're recording. It hasn't been echoed on the WRU website. So it is just a state. It's like SIP2 making a statement about IBM.
Well, it's all up for debate. Well, anyway, that's it for tonight. Thanks a million for watching, and thanks to the lads too. Cheers.